Welcome to World Med School. My name is Niaz Banaei. I'm a clinical microbiologist at a university hospital in Northern California. In this micro lecture, I'm going to talk about laboratory diagnosis of tuberculosis. Laboratory diagnosis of pulmonary tuberculosis by conventional methods is one of the most challenging things the laboratory has to do for three reasons. First, the sputum sample has to be collected through the oral cavity, which gets contaminated with oral bacteria, and therefore the sample has to be decontaminated. Second, because mycobacteria are slow growing, the cultures have to be incubated for up to 6 weeks to recover the organisms. And third, because mycobacterium tuberculosis is a highly infectious organism, all the cultivation work has to be done in a biosafety laboratory. Laboratory diagnosis of tuberculosis by a conventional method is a multi-step procedure that starts with specimen collection. The first requirement for collection of a good quality sputum sample is an alert and cooperative patient who can be instructed to rinse out his or her mouth with water. The patient then must be encouraged to cough deeply to expectorate a specimen of lower respiratory secretions. In order to increase the sensitivity of culture and microscopy, the volume of sputum specimen should exceed 5 mL. And lastly, the patient has to be instructed to provide 2 to 3 samples collected over 1 to 2 days. And specimen processing for microbacteriology depends on the type of sample. If the sample is sterile, the fluids have to be concentrated and tissues have to be homogenized. For the great majority of sputum samples that are non-sterile, they have to undergo decontamination and concentration. This slide shows a sputum sample, which first has to be treated with a mucolytic agent, typically N-acetylcysteine. The oral flora have to be killed by treating the sample with a sodium hydroxide. And lastly, this specimen has to be neutralized with some sort of a buffer. The entire process has to be done in a biosafety cabinet, in a biosafety laboratory, and the technologist should only work with one specimen at a time to prevent cross-contamination. At the end of this process, there is a specimen concentrate that can be used to inoculate media for culture, prepare a slide for microscopy, and if indicated, perform nucleic acid amplification test. Next step in microbacteriology is smear microscopy. There are two types of stains available for microscopy, carbofusion and fluorochrome stains. The carbofusion stains are less sensitive because the technologist has to read 300 high power fields, which typically takes about 10 minutes. The fluorochrome stain smears have to be read at 30 low power fields, which typically takes a few minutes. Reporting of acid fast smears is shown on this slide. On the right for fluorochrome stains, no organism seen is reported as negative. 1 to 2 on the entire slide is reported as suspicious or indeterminate. 3 to 9 per 10 field is reported as 1+, 1 to 9 per field as 2+, 10 to 90 per field as 3+, and greater than 90 per field as 4+. Overall, microscopy has a sensitivity of about 50%, so it misses half of the TB cases. And there are many reasons why the sensitivity is poor, but the number one factor is the number of organisms per mil of sputum. You need at least 100,000 bacteria per mil to consistently detect smears by microscopy. Next step is cultivation of mycobacteria in culture. Currently, it is recommended that both liquid and solid media are used. Liquid media is recommended because liquid culture systems are automated, and also they are more rapid because they detect bacterial metabolism instead of formation of colonies, which can take longer. However, solid media has the advantage of detecting mixed infections, and also if you have a contamination, you may still be able to recover mycobacterium tuberculosis. This slide shows three different commercial automated liquid culture systems. These systems detect different markers of growth. The TREC system detects change in pressure in the culture headspace. BACT alert system detects production of carbon dioxide by bacteria. And the MIDGET system detects consumption of oxygen by the bacteria. In the MIDGET tubes, also known as mycobacterial growth indicator, as bacteria grow, they consume oxygen, and as oxygen depleted, a reporter starts to fluoresce at the bottom of the tube and indicate positive results. The two types of solid media used include egg-based and agar-based. The most common egg-based media used worldwide is Lowenstein-Jensen. This media also is supplemented with malachite green, which is an antimicrobial dye that inhibits non-mycobacteria. The most common agar-based media used is Middlebrook. Both liquid and solid cultures are incubated at 37 degrees, minimum of 6 weeks or longer. Liquid culture systems are checked automatically by the instrument. Solid cultures are checked weekly by manually going through the cultures and inspecting them visually. Once there is a positive liquid culture, the technologists have to ensure that there is mycobacterial growth, and this is done by subculturing an aliquot on blood agar. Also, gram stain is used to rule out gram positive and gram negative organisms, and an acid fast stain is used to confirm the presence of mycobacteria. For bacterial identification, there is currently both phenotypic and genotypic methods available. Phenotypic methods include biochemical tests, which are not used commonly in laboratories anymore. Instead, other methods are being used. One attractive method is lateral flow immunochromatographic assay. This slide shows an example of lateral flow where an aliquot of liquid culture or emulsified solid culture is loaded on the cartridge, and formation of a band where it says T indicates positivity for Mycobacterium tuberculosis culture. Overall, the lateral flow assay is highly sensitive and specific, and currently three different manufacturers produce this assay. Other phenotypics include high-performance liquid chromatography and, more recently, MALDI-TOF, also known as matrix-assisted laser desorption ionization time-of-flight mass spectrometry, has become available for identification of mycobacterial cultures. Genotypic methods include probes, PCR, and sequencing. Probes are most commonly used. GEMPROBE is one of the earlier assays that became available for identification of Mycobacterium tuberculosis culture. A probe, when bound to its target, leads to light production and confirms the presence of Mycobacterium tuberculosis. Another probe that's commonly used is LIME probe, which is made by two different manufacturers. The first step involves amplifying a target, and then the amplicons are hybridized with the probe on a nitrocellulose paper, and formation of a band indicates a positive reaction, which corresponds to a particular mycobacterial species. The final step in laboratory diagnosis of tuberculosis is antimicrobial susceptibility testing. It is currently recommended that all first isolates from new patients undergo testing with first-line drugs. If two or more of the first-line drugs are resistant, to proceed to susceptibility testing with second-line drugs. The gold standard method for susceptibility testing of Mycobacterium tuberculosis is solid media. A method that's used most commonly is the proportion method, where a critical concentration of drug is exposed to the bacteria, and if 99% inhibition in colony-forming units is observed, then that indicates susceptibility. In many laboratories, or automated antimicrobial susceptibility testing, with a MIDGET system, a tube is inoculated with bacteria with no antibiotic. This is a control tube. The other tubes are inoculated with bacteria on each of the antibiotics, and the instrument follows the growth in the control tube. Once the growth index reaches a certain threshold, then the instrument compares the growth index in the tubes with antibiotics to determine if they have passed a certain threshold, which indicates antibiotic resistance. So as I have illustrated to you, laboratory diagnosis of tuberculosis by conventional methods is both laborious and lengthy. For this reason, many laboratories in the recent years have switched to a nucleic acid amplification test for direct detection of Mycobacterium tuberculosis in specimens. A number of commercial nucleic acid amplification tests are currently available. One of these assays, the GeneXpert MTB-RIF assay, is believed to be a game changer in tuberculosis diagnosis by the experts for the reason that this assay combines extraction and amplification all in a single cartridge. This slide shows the performance of nucleic acid amplification test. To summarize it, when the smear microscopy result is positive, nucleic acid amplification tests have a sensitivities in 80s to 90s. For smear negative samples, the sensitivity is lower, about 60 to 70%. Nucleic acid amplification tests, in addition to determining whether Mycobacterium tuberculosis DNA is present or not, they can also determine whether the organism is resistant to particular anti-tuberculosis antibiotics. As an example shown here, genotypic testing for rifampin has a sensitivity of 98%, and for isoniazid, the sensitivity is about 85%. So, in conclusion and summary, laboratory diagnosis of tuberculosis by conventional methods is a multi-step process that is both lengthy and laborious. However, one can use nucleic acid amplification tests to simplify and speed up this process and provide a more timely diagnosis of tuberculosis.